Good evening all. Welcome to a new session of NTV's My Teacher Live program. I know you are all in a festive mood of Christmas and coming New Year. So it's not a good time to study to about all the subjects, and because it's now I know that it's a very relaxation time to all, for you all. But we have to continue our sessions, especially the continuation of the last session. So let's start today's session with a quote of Ban Ki-moon, General Secretary of United Nations. General Secretary of United Nations. The clear and present danger of climate change means we cannot burn our way to prosperity. We already rely too heavily on fossil fuels. We need to find a new sustainable path to the future we want. We need a clean industrial revolution. Right. What can you understand from this quote or for the wordings of Ban Ki-moon? As we know that there is a drastic climatic change is happening around the world. What's the main reason for this? This is because we all know that it's because of our way of the human activities. And when we study about this economy, that is Indian economy, in the eve of independence, because we have been discussing with this topic for the last two sessions, Indian economy on the eve of independence, how we can correlate this quote with the Indian economy in the eve of independence. Because one of the main reasons we are problems we are facing due to various pollutions and climatic changes. As a result of these climatic changes, it affects in various fields, not only in any particular sector, it affects in various dimensions, in different ways, in geographical area, in the industries, the healthcare facilities, everywhere. And we all know that we are with the natural resources, because without these natural resources, it's very difficult to make the development or make new industries, especially in the manufacturing industries, that is in the agriculture. We know that because we were dealing with the agriculture sector, that is the pre-independence period. How was the impact of the this agriculture sector because of this British colonization? And we have discussed about the land revenues system, or the RAN, that is the revenue settlement, the three classes. That is the Mahalwari, the Rotwari, the permanent settlement or the Zamindari settlement, and what are the impacts of this settlement because of this British colonization, how it affected adversely in the Indian economy. And we all know that it is India always had a very good economy, or very wealthy, very rich country from the prehistorical period itself, because of the different civilization which started by the Indus Valley civilization on the banks of river Indus. And we are always depending on these natural resources for various manufacturing processes. So, but because of these improper utilization of these resources, of our natural resources, results in a great a negative effect or an adverse effect to the various parts, which is various parts of the world. In this way, we can know that, and at the same time, we know that when, because in the last sessions also, I already discussed about the fuel capacity, because nowadays we are all depending on this fuel for various purposes, and we know that I have made some comparison of this. That is the fuel reserves in UAE, in America and all. And we have found out that in the future, how would be the reservoirs, how would be it in the future also. So, showed that the data showed that there is a great depletion for the natural resources, and it would be a negative, definitely it would be a negative impact on these various areas because of this depletion of these natural resources. As a result of this, it is a high time to think about such kind of resources in a proper way, or utilization of these natural resources, and it's very important to find a new method to use or to proper use, otherwise to find a new fuel. It is now we know that the technology is all is very much developed in every field. So with this help of technologies, it's high time to think about the various factors to improve this type of fuels, or to find a new method to find these fuels necessary for different sectors. That's why Mr. Ban Ki-moon emphasized that we need a clean industrial revolution. And also when in this time I point out that there is a need for the importance of the planning commission by the far-sighted vision of then Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru about the planning, that is a setup of a planning commission, which always emphasized there is a need of public and private sectors, or a need of mixed economy. So industrial revolution is a backbone of any country's economy. So there, and at the same time, how to develop this industrial economy, or they made an industrial change, a new technology towards for the better, or for the development of the economy, or towards the growth. So there is a need of sustainable method to find this, or to preserve these resources, or to find out new fuel for the future generation. That's very important. And I've made some strategic plans, because when we tell about, or we think about the planning commissions, there is a need of some kind of plans, or that is called some tactics or some strategic plan is needed in order to make the formulation, that is, it includes a formulation and implementation of some policies or procedures. It includes some that is implementation process also. It's always towards the goal, that is, there should be a clear cut objectives which consist of the goals, or it should consist of vision, mission, and always supports the values, and integrity should be maintained. So this includes a strategic planning. So that in Indian economy also, before independence also, we could find out that in the British rule also made that in every civilization they had made different types of strategic plans towards the development. But at the same time, we always emphasize that it was negative effect, but at the same time there were some positive impacts also, which made some vision towards certain policies or certain objectives towards the succession, towards that succession, or that succession planning is very important. So that strategic planning or tactic rules, which is a course of action in which with the formulation, it tries to formulation of policies by seeing the internal and external environment according or towards the satisfaction or accomplishment of objectives or goals. So when we combine all together, it not only consists of only one, that is, not only consists of one subject, that is maybe agriculture sector, or the industrial sector, or manufacturing sector, or the foreign trade, or the demographic situation, or the employment status, but also it includes all these, as it includes strategic planning, or it includes the study about the historical aspects of the rule of this British Raj, how they made these policies, how they made the negative, what were the negative impacts, and about the different industries, how they, made so many, face, what are the problems faced by these industries. So these all try to help, always these will emphasize or try to help to know about the problems in a detailed way, so that we can make some plans according to these problems to for the better development. That's why here also we could say that this, the first slide about this quote of this Mr. Ban Ki-moon, is that we need to find out new methods, that is innovative methods to make new fuels, that is to find out a new sustainable path to the future for a clean industrial revolution. That should, because we have to transfer these resources to the next, to our next generation, because it's, we are accountable for that, and it is our responsibility to transfer these to our next generation. Why we are using, why we have these why we are in a such a safe place, or in a we can in a comfortable zone, because our ancestors or earlier people were utilized in a proper way. That's why we are in such a comfortable zone. So in the same manner, it's our responsibility to transfer to the next generation. At the same time, along with that, there is a need of innovative or creative changes, because only through creativeness or only through that innovative mind we can make new challenges. Try to make it as every challenge. So for this main purpose, there are a lot of small sub factors are there for towards the development of such a final product. And when we say about this Indian economy on the eve of independence, we were discussing about the agriculture sector, about the foreign trade, and last session we had discussed about the that land system, about the revenue settlement, and about the different classification, what were the different practices by the British Raj when they dealt with land settlement or the revenue settlement, how they collected the taxes, or how how the farmers faced all the problems, or how they made their payment, tax payment, or how they developed, or was any development for the agriculture sector. So it was through different systems like Mahalwari system, Rotwari system, permanent settlement, or otherwise called Zamindari system. Out of that Zamindari system and the Mahalwari system, we could find out, that is, how was the impact and the similarity between these Rotwari system and the Zamindari system, etc. So today we are just going to have into a peep into the industrial sectors, how the early efforts of industrialization, or what are the different types of industrial sectors, how the developments in the cotton industry, the jute industry. We all know that earlier the handicraft, it is India was very famous for the handicraft industry because of this craftsmanship and the quality of the our products, and the, that is one of the reasons that the always the raw materials were transferred to British for their development, for final products, or to develop their manufacturing sector. So that was also a negative impact on the Indian economy because of this this transference or being the export of these products, the raw materials from India to British, because they need to protect and promote their industry. So the history of modern industrial development in India dates back to about last 150 years, and which got accelerated during the period that is after independence, and it was mainly because of main reasons, and we all know that it is capital or the finance is one of the major reasons, or it is a backbone of or the prime maker of growth. Anyway, capital for industry and entrepreneurial zeal were severely and conspicuously very very scarce in India when this it was ruled by the East India Company, or when they stepped this East India Company into India in the 18th century, that is in the 17th century, that is 1600 to 1874. And after that, there are a lot of changes happened in different sectors. And since India was under the British rule for almost 200 years, the British government found it unprofitable and unnecessary developments in the industrial sectors or in the manufacturing sectors, because as I've told you that they were always emphasized on the protection and promotion of their workers, because their technology, they always highlighted to improve their technology. And in India and vice versa, in India the problem was they were not getting enough money for their agricultural productivity, and they always the British wanted to increase the labor force without giving enough money or collected more taxes from there. So it was a great burden, and they became money lenders, more money lenders were there in India, and they were always trying to increase the number of, it is the labor force, instead of emphasizing or giving importance for the development in the machine or in the tools or in the technological advancement. Later it was found out that there is a need of scientific development, and there is a need of socio-technological changes, or there is a need of combination of socio-technological development. Always there is a need of social, it is the humanity plus, it is a workforce plus technology. Unless and until there is no change in the, or developments in the technology, it's very difficult to make improvement towards the economy or the growth of or development of a country. So the imperialist capital came in this country as a matter of colonial policy, the policy of subordination of Indian to British capital. It was only after the First World War, that is in 1914 to 1918, that patronage for industrial development was visible, as Britain's supremacy all over the globe came under serious threat. So that the World War, that is also, it is, we have to think not about the First World War. First World War and also the Great Depression. This is in 1914 to 1918. So this World War and Great Depression had made a lot of changes for made many adverse effect to the population, to the entire population, to the demographic factors, resulted in poverty or malnutrition or the loss of land, various issues were there. So and at the same time, these problems along with these the tax policies or these the revenue systems or land revenue settlement or this these all also made so many changes in the civilization, that is in the that is the economy of India. So let's have a look at the early efforts of industrialization. As I have told you that there are various subtopics that they about the agriculture sectors, about the foreign trade, the industrial sectors, about the demographic factors. And I've already told you about the demographic factors. When we know, when we think about demographic factors, it's important or it's an inevitable matter to know about the census, that is in 1881, about the census, which, and it was shown that there is an inequality or there was no stability in the population. And these all factors, that is the First World War and Great Depression, also affected a great a lot in this kind of demographic factors of the factors in India. So when we say about this early efforts of the industrialization, we know that there were very advanced development in the sector, in different, that is cotton industry, jute industry, about various kinds of handicrafts, and it was always attracted by the different colonization, that is the British or this other Dutch or so many other civilizations, because of this high craftsmanship, and the quality wise also it was very good, because our demographic factors, infrastructure also was very good at that time itself. And in the now also in the recent times, infrastructure has made a lot of change towards the India to make a manufacturing hub, and always the far-sighted vision of the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi, about the different changes in the infrastructure to make in India initiative. So in this way, always, it is, as time passes, there are different changes would happen. Definitely there are definitely different changes would happen. So when we think about this Indian economy on the eve of independence, we should understand that we should try to find out that what are or when or where these type of modern industries made changes, or how it can how it affected the Indian economy. So the modern industry or the large scale industry is a mid 19th century phenomenon. So before the British conquest, India's supremacy in the industrial field reached its high watermark, that is India was called the industrial workshop of the world during the 17th and 18th centuries. So, and demand at the same time, this, there was a great demand for this cotton goods in England during this time was unprecedented. And this, as I have told you, that because of their craft, of the intense craftsmanship and the quality. So we can see a slide of early efforts of industrialization. Modern industry or the large scale industry is a mid 19th century phenomenon. Before the British conquest, India's supremacy in the industrial field reached its high water mark. India was called the industrial workshop of the world during the 17th and 18th centuries. Demand for Indian cotton goods in England during the time was unprecedented. Indian cotton cloth was considered by Englishmen as the badge of style and fashion of the time. So that's very one thing is about the efforts of the industrialization is in the cotton industry. At the same time, the woolen and silk items were also in huge demand. All this development brought untold miseries in England and other parts of Europe. And firstly, import of Indian goods destroyed the prospect of woolen and silk industries. And the second reason is that the unemployment and suffering among the weavers mounted up. Thirdly, change in the composition of India's trade led to export of treasure from England to India. So when next is cotton industry, then at the same time the woolen and silk industry. So in this woolen and silk industry also was well developed at that time, but because of these type of issues from this British colonization, it also affected a great system of unemployment, and also the productivity was very less because of this land revenue settlement, and also because of this revenue settlement and land settlement. Because of their policies, always try to make some hardships for these workers or these agriculturists, because majority of them were in the agriculture sector. So this trade also was a great problem, because the high quality products were always they tried to send to, and actually the worker or the agriculturists or the farmers were unable to use their products, that is the products or the yields from their own country, and they had to pay more taxes for their own products. And it was mainly when we discussed about the zamindari system, we could find out that everything was a decision by the zamindaris who were that is them headed by the British rulers. Though the zamindaris were from Indians, but the zamindaris had the right to discuss the policies or to maintain the policies or about the how to manage the land for years, maybe for 20 to 40 years. They didn't have the authority to change the policies and rules once they had set up. But everything, the decision, that is the administration and the judicial powers, were vested with the British rulers also. So there was a great problem of this unemployment, and we have discussed also in the the agriculture sector, there is an undiscussed unemployment. So these problems were practiced right from the early, when we look back into the early history itself. So that's why I've told you that there is a need of change, that is there is a need of strategic plan in every sector. So we'll see that slide about the woolen and silk industry items, how it was in a huge demand. The slide of woolen and silk items were also in a huge demand. All this development brought untold miseries in England and other parts of Europe. Firstly, import of Indian goods destroyed the prospect of woolen and silk industries. Secondly, unemployment and suffering among the weavers mounted up. Thirdly, change in the composition of India's trade led to the export of treasure from England to India. So this was the problem with the woolen and silk items, how they face the woolen and silk items. So this are okay, right? So this is the problem with the cotton industry, then the woolen and silk industry. Because of this, there was a lack of productivity and unemployment was also there. And next industrial sector we'll discuss about some other industrial sectors. How that is the list of some other industrial this sectors and when it was started or how it maintained in that time. Or whether it had made any impact on the modern development, that is towards the industrial revolution, had made any changes in the industrial revolution, is intense industrial revolution, and how whether it had made any or any strategic plans, through any strategic plans made any changes in these areas. So the first charcoal based iron smelting was attempted in 1853, which failed by 1874. So first I'm going to deal up in the that is in that 19th century, how it affected the industrial sectors were in the 19th century. But the first successful adventures were in the field of textile industry itself, that is cotton press by a Parsi, C.N. Diwar at Mumbai in 1854. So that was in the textile industry itself, the development. It was in the 19th century, in the 80s, it was in the textile industry itself. And a jute spinning mill by George Ackland at Risram, that is near Kolkata, in 1855. And by 1860, 10 other cotton mills were started in Mumbai. So you can get a clear picture by seeing this slide, industrial sectors. The first charcoal based iron smelting was attempted in 1853, which failed by 1874. The successful adventures were in the field of textile industry, that is cotton press by a Parsi, C.N. Diwar at Mumbai in 1854. A jute spinning mill by George Ackland at Risra near Kolkata in 1855. By 1860, 10 other cotton mills were started in Mumbai. So this was some of the factors in the industrial sectors. So the real expansion, but the real expansion of the cotton industry. So when we say about the industrial sectors, the sector which should be highlighted is always about the cotton industry. So the cotton textile industry was noticed during 1870s following the spurt in demand in the wake of American Civil War. By 1875 to 76, the number of mills rose to 47, of which about 62% were located within the city of Mumbai, that is 21% in Mumbai Presidency. The laying of first rail line. So at the same time, in the same that is almost near, that is in 1854 also, there is a great improvement for the in the area of transportation, that is the rail. This last session I have discussed about the two personalities which always try to make some contributions to the Indian economy in the eve of independence, Dadabhai Naroji. And at the same time, we have to think of another one. It is about that is the Tata Steel. So Tata and Iron Steel also made a much contributions, and now also it has its own footsteps towards the economy. So when we say about these contributions, the other one is also about the development in the rail. So the laying of first rail line between Mumbai and Thane in 1854 proved beneficial in this context. So until 1913 to 14, before First World War, the number of cotton textile mills rose to 271 with total employment of 260,000. So this cotton industry, so always we have to highlight about this cotton industry, it is the development in the textile industry when we say about the industrial sectors. Can see a slide about the developments, about the more notes about the developments in the cotton industry. The progress was not very encouraging. The expansion in cotton textile industry was noticed during 1870s following the spurt in demand in the wake of American Civil War. By 1875 to 76, the number of mills rose to 47. Of which about 62% were located within the city of Mumbai. The laying of first rail line between Mumbai and Thane in 1854 proved beneficial in this context. Until 1913 to 14, before First World War, the number of cotton textile mills rose to 271 with total employment of 260,000. So this was in the case of the cotton textile industry. So thus we can say the efforts of the industrialization. Right, so the cotton industry, how it affected, that is the British rule, how it was in the pre-independence day about the woolen, about the silk and the cotton industry, or generally we can say about the textile industry. And at the same time, we have to understand about the jute industry. And we all know that it was also very developed, or India was very wealthy in case of jute industry. But later, there is a partition, is undivided partition in this the Pakistan. So it made a great challenge to the jute industry in India. It had affected a great in the Indian economy. So the jute industry, the progress was not very encouraging in case of jute textile industry because of these reasons. And the second jute mill was set up in 1859 with spinning and weaving facilities. So jute industry. And two more mills were added by 1862, in this 19th century itself. And a great development came during 1869 to 1884 with the addition of 23 mills, accounting for an average daily employment of 47,863. So the productivity was increased, at the same time it provides a great employment at that time itself. And by 1913 to 14, the number of jute mills increased to 64, which provided average daily employment to 219,288 people. So majority of these mills were located in and around the city of Kolkata. The owners were exclusively Europeans or British. That was the case of the jute industry. We can see the slide of about the jute industry to know more about this industry. The progress was not encouraging in the case of jute textile industry. The second jute mill was set up in 1859 with spinning and weaving facilities. Two more mills were added by 1862. A spurt came during 1869 to 1884 with the addition of 23 new mills, accounting for an average daily employment of 47,863. So this was the condition, and we could see that how much employment it provided in the year 1913 and 1914, and how the production increased in the jute mills and where it was located. So it was mainly located in the city of Kolkata. Right, so that was about the jute industry. So we have discussed about the textile, we are discussing about the textile industries, cotton industry, woolen silk industry, jute industry. And when it comes to some metals, it's important to know about the iron and steel industry. And this was also, there were a lot of drawbacks for this iron and steel industry. So, the beginning it was much delayed because of these policies or because of these various taxes or procedures of this British Raj. But it commenced with the functioning of Bengal Iron Works Limited in 1874 at Kulti. It is in West Bengal. So, it was shut down in few years and revived in 1881. So, the real development was initiated with setting up of Tata Iron and Steel Company at Jamshedpur in 1908. In 1913 to 14, the company produced 1,55,000 tons of pig iron and 78,000 tons of steel ingots. So, iron and steel industry. About the iron and steel industry. The major, as I have told you, that the major development or the great revolution in this industrial areas or sectors by the upcoming of this Tata Iron and Steel in Jamshedpur. We can see the slide about the iron and steel industry, about this measurement, about the year and all. Iron and steel industry, the beginning was more delayed, and it commenced with the functioning of Bengal Iron Works Limited in 1874 in West Bengal. It was shut down in few years and was revived in 1881. The real development was initiated with the setting up of Tata Iron and Steel Company at Jamshedpur in 1908. In 1913-14, the company produced 1,55,000 tons of pig iron and 78,000 tons of steel ingots. Right. So, after this textile industry, this iron and steel industry, the other industry is about the paper mill, woolen or brewery industries. Brewery industries means is business which relates with production of beer or sell, that is the making and selling. That is, it makes the business which makes and sells beer in a commercial way. It is the brewery industries. Paper, that is brewery. It is brewery industry. So, the first paper mill of the country was started near Kolkata in 1870, and two paper mills in Bengal and one at Lucknow, Uttar Pradesh, was started between 1902 and 1905. So, it was in the 20th century, and some woolen textile mills were set up at Kanpur, Uttar Pradesh, Punjab and Bangalore, Karnataka, to meet the requirements of military, police and railway personnel. And this was an added advantage to the Britishers also, because in order to transport or for to make during some wars, especially during wars or for to military purposes. And at the same time, in this moment, I would like to tell about this Suez Canal also. But about the details of the Suez Canal, I will continue to in the next session. So, but these all provide, it is these contributions of the British Raj made so much developments for increase in the ports increase in the help like great lot of import and export of this or trade. It increases the trade between different nations. So, that can make a great change towards the economy of the or the Indian economy or the economy of the country. So, in 1902, there were 27 breweries. Nearly all European armed, employing about 6,500 people to meet the demand from military and resident European civilians. So, from all these data, we could find out that there is a there was always a positive impact, that it provides a great employment. But these are all the step or the foundation stone for the future industrial development. So, for the modern development or for a large scale industries, these are all the backbone for this development or towards the economy of the nation. So, we can see a slide about the paper mill, woolen and brewery industries. The first paper mill of the country was started at Balgan near Kolkata in 1870. Two more paper mills in Bengal and one at Lucknow was started between 1902 and 1905. Some woolen textile mills were set up at Kanpur, Punjab, Karnataka to meet the requirements of military, police and railway personnel. In 1902, there were 27 breweries, nearly all European owned, employing about 6,500 people. In order to meet demand from military and resident European civilians. Right. So, because of, these impacts of this British Raj in various industries, cotton is in the textile industries of cotton industry, woolen silk, jute industry, iron steel and in the woolen brewery industry, and all these made a drastic change towards the towards the industrial revolution. And in this way, we could say that it can be interconnected with this First World War. So, this impact of the World Wars on the whole was beneficial for the growth of Indian industries, because India became the source of supply for elite operations east of Zeus due to obstruction in foreign sources of supply. Here it is the development of the Zeus Canal made a much contributions towards the development of the Indian economy, and it is some details are mentioned in your textbook also about the Zeus Canal, but it's important to Google it to get more information about the Zeus Canal. So this first impact world was the First World War. In one way, the First World War was in 1914 to 1918, had made some contributions towards the industrial revolution, to make some contribution towards the Indian economy. That is because India became this supply for elite operations east of Zeus due to obstruction in foreign source of supply. So now we'll have some shift from this in industries, different industrials, because otherwise it's very difficult to remember all these years or how it had made changes in every year, which are the different types of sectors. Actually, there are a lot of other sectors also other than this cotton, woolen, iron, then brewery industries and all. About the railway industry, about the development in the railway system. But when we think about, as I have told you, that about this strategic planning, that is about the planning commission, we know about the constitution also made by eminent personalities from various fields or various areas from the agriculture, from medical area, from engineering. So, in the technological, so everyone has contributed from a number of personalities had contributed towards the constitution of India also. So, in this, when we connect all these factors, it's important to know about the some plans, that is the strategic plans, that is the importance of management. As I've told you that there is a need of socio-technical changes. In the same way, there is a need of some management rules also into these developmental plans. So, when I say about these development plans, I have told you that about the strategic. So, first you have to just think about the what do you mean by a strategy? As I have told you that strategy means some tactic plans or some rules. It is a course of action. It can be classified into formulation and implementation. So, when we say about the strategic planning, the most important things, two important things are formulation and implementation. Because the next process of formulation is formulating all the policies, all the rules or regulations, or all the goals, objectives, it needs to be implemented. So that process is called implementation. So when I say about strategy, it means it is a course of action and specification of resources. We all know that without resources, nothing can be done. That is, it's a combination of men, machine, money, material. We need all type of resources. We all know that the human resources are the backbone of an organization. We know that for any business we need money, and at the same time we need technology or we need material. So in this way, all these factors are interconnected. So it's a combination of these for this all resources. It's a course of action for what? Towards the accomplishment of goals or objectives. Because first we need to make some or guide, that is make to make some enlist the priorities or some goals. It is in the form of objectives. And after this, when we say about this, we can say about the strategic plan. So strategic plan means it consists of short term and long term. Mainly we are highlighting on the long term plans for 8 to 10 years. And by how we can make this strategic plan? By defining these strategic and policies or different protocols to ensure the achievement of goals. So the ultimate thing is to achieve the achievement of goals. I have made one slide to know about the different important points for this strategy and strategic plan, and it will be easy to know what are the different factors related with this strategic plan. You can see a slide that what is strategy. See, the strategy means it's a course of action with specification of resources to achieve specific objective. And strategic planning, it's a statement of long-term plans by defining strategies and policies to ensure the achievement of goals. So you can see that it relates with different factors like competitive advantage, a proper direction is needed, and a strategic fit is needed, a proper environment, and which we have to emphasize on the internal and external environment, then about the future, about the objectives, combination of all resources. That's why we can say that it is a course of action. So it involves these all factors. So competitive advantage, right? So it's a competitive advantage, because every session I used to emphasize that in this 21st era of competitive or cutthroat and world, we need, or all businesses are competitive. And all the businesses are in, or wherever we look, because outside when the external environment, we can see that everywhere it is competition. So it's very difficult for any business to make a grow, because there are various reasons for these strategic planning or for various businesses. Because first one is survive. Everyone needs to survive. And in the last session also I have started with one slide that about the wordings of Charles Darwin. That is, we need, because adaptability to change is very important. We know that some or majority have the strength or intelligence or knowledge. Everything is on one side, but on the other side, main thing we need is adaptability to change. Those who can adaptable to change, they can survive in this 21st era of this, not only in the 21st era, in the coming, but also in the coming years. So why we need this type of strategy? Because we all need to survive, and definitely it is for higher profits. Because only through higher profits, or depending upon the turnover, or depending upon this revenue, it is depending on this revenue, because of this high profit. Because only with this high profit we can survive, and definitely a prestige is needed. It provides a prestige, so increased prestige. And our studies also, our topic is about, what is about our topic? It is economy. So naturally, for the increase in the GDP, but some economists highlighted that The GDP cannot be the only criterion to find out the economy of a country. And I have also told you several times that there are other various factors, but I am not going into those factors. So here this is economy, one factor is economy, then larger market share, definitely we need larger market share, then social benefits. So you can see that slide of need for expansion strategy. It is for survival, higher profits, increased prestige, economies of scale, then larger market share, social benefits. Right. So in this ways we can say that these are the reasons for towards the need for expansion strategy. As a result, we would make a strategic plan. So in the same way we can correlate this with the it is economics also, in any management field we can relate with, because everywhere when you look around it is everywhere it is business. So in this manner there is a need of strategic plan in Indian the economics also, when we deal with this Indian economy in the eve of independence, every time as time passes there are different strategic plans according to the adverse effect or the negative or the drop or the according to these ill effects of various sectors or the policies, they try to make so many changes, and this will pass on to the every generations as well. So that's why I made this combination of all these factors in this Indian economy. So I think okay, right, it's time to wind up the session. So hope it was informative about the different industries, especially the industrial sectors with the textile industry and other manufacturing industries, and about the strategic planning, the importance of strategic planning. So thanks for watching. We'll see you next Monday. Till then, take care. Bye bye.